Okay, thanks, Roger. It's a great pleasure to visit you. Part of the message will be we don't have to worry about being replaced very soon. So I mean, it's obviously very interesting and open-ended question. I chose this time frame of a decade because I think that is the period where one could hope to make any kind of prediction. I think things have changed so dramatically, even over the last decade, that it's you know, obviously dangerous, but you know, nevertheless, you know, interesting. So I'm going to start with a bit of history, a bit of a review of what's already out there in terms of software, media, technologies to help us mathematical scientists, meaning very broadly, you know, mathematicians, physicists, all of us who use mathematical concepts in our work, and then extrapolate from there. So again, it's I think you know, important to go, you know, see clearly where we're at, and the many other possible ways that math and our thinking could change. But computers are an obvious place to start, where great changes are being made right now. And so let's start with a very, very brief sort of a history of computer science. Of course, this is a great place to start such a history, as being one of the founding institutions. And in those very early days, it was the idea of a computer was essentially a programmable calculator. It was intended for numerical calculations. And over the 50s, the pioneers of computer science were, you know, saw that this was a much more general tool, that one could do information retrieval and search in a much more flexible and adaptive way. There's the whole topic of control systems and cybernetics that gave rise to, you know, the fields of applied mathematics. Artificial intelligence, you know, goes back in a very concrete way to the 50s. And in fact, trying to get the computer to come up with its own logical proofs was one of the first projects that the Royal Simon tried in AI. It was catch-all category of natural computing, which means it's not as much a term we use now, but computing inspired by computing done in the real world, and that's where neural networks might be thought to start. And of course, computation in the style of the original calculation, simulation, has already had tremendous impact on the mathematical sciences and has created even more fields. So again, this question of AI, although the actual accomplishments of those early years were modest, and it was, not understanding of what's involved in solving symbolic problems, and in particular the fact that almost anything that straightforward that you try to do runs into a theory of exponential search. So besides asking the questions, I think the impact of those early years was to lay out some of the basic techniques, for example, the basic technologies for symbolic manipulation, languages like the Lisp, that were the foundations for what came after. So skipping ahead, you could argue that the next event of that magnitude in the history of computation was the internet. And again, we're just going to focus on how these things affect our lives or ability to do research. And I can tell a story from my own field, and some people here as well, that the internet very much changed how physicists and theoretical physicists, string theorists, did their work. So I was a graduate student at Caltech, where John Schwartz was one of the creators of superstring theory. And the mid-80s, when I was there, was a what we call the super string revolution, what the field was, the basic map of the field was being made. So it's a very attractive, but also very frustrating for a student at Caltech, because to basically explain the story, we would hear about all these great ideas, you know, the heterotic string, Clausius magnification, and we would learn about the details through preprints. You know, we'd send in the mail, you know, a box full of, you know, draft papers, and read them. So we would read them, and we would, you know, slowly absorb and come up with our own questions and ideas. And by the time we had started working, the next box of preprints would come. And our questions and ideas were pretty much all asked and explored and then largely worked out, in many cases by people here in Princeton, such as Edward. And so it wasn't very easy, but we continued, and long enough to live through the second superstring revolution. And that one you can actually, again, point to a starting point and a creator, and if you had to choose one, it would be Ashok Sen, who at the time was essentially working alone on this in India. And he laid out the, not a new idea to him, but this idea of superstring duality. He wrote some of the first papers showing how you could actually test the ideas, not just words, but something that leads to, you know, explicit mathematical predictions that you can test. And that created a lot of excitement, and you might think the same thing would happen as in the first superstring revolution, but this time it was distributed around the world. Sen remained at the forefront. There were important developments coming from around the world. The difference was exactly the internet, that one could distribute papers instantaneously, and anybody anywhere could, in principle, stay up to date with the cutting edge of research. So these changes clearly affect how we do research. So arguably, if we're going to look at the potential of the internet, I think there's no better example to look at than the Wikipedia, which when this was started in the 2000s, I am told people that, you know, thought about this, read about this, said this is not going to work. You know, there are encyclopedias. You're trying to make an encyclopedia. Encyclopedias need a board of editors, need centralized control. You know, just to think that people around the world could type stuff into this, it'll never work. And of course, it worked much better than that prediction. It's not the ideal source of scholarly information, but again, it's a valuable first resource, and it's an example of the potential of it. Okay, so now we are in a third leap of machine learning, which again, you know, those not in the program here have read a great deal and seen talks, you know, and we've all seen these very impressive results of machine learning, which continues to develop. It certainly has not passed its peak, and which has huge numbers of applications and very large research groups in the industry pursuing it. So the question for this talk, although machine learning, of course, is a mathematical concept, and one can study it theoretically mathematically, well, how could we use it to amplify our own ability to do research, in principle to do research, but in case to help us solve the day-to-day problems that we face as researchers and as teachers. Okay, so I'm going to start by going through some of the tools, software, which are out there, and I have no time, and basically these are all things which are well documented on the web, so if there are terms here that you don't recognize, you can type it into Google, and they're all interesting. And this slide is in the way of media, ways of working with text, equations, papers, distributing, facilitating communication. So we all use LaTeX, the archive I've mentioned. There are notational standards for representing mathematical formulas in a definite way to facilitate communication now between computers. Search engines, I'll get into that some more. Notebooks is a nice kind of format which was developed originally by Wolfram Research for Mathematica, where you can combine a series of interactive computations, in their case, in a I'll get to symbolic manipulation programs in the next slide, but the idea, it's as a media, it's a general idea which has been adopted elsewhere. On social media, you can ask a question, and the you know, large community of people that read that, you know, this website, Stack Overflow, is a famous example, can perhaps answer, or perhaps have already encountered your question. So there are these various tools. Okay, moving on to computational tools, things that we use to really help us. If we have a calculation or interesting piece of data that somebody, problem somebody's already worked on with precise answers. Okay, so symbolic algebra. Many of you, certainly probably almost all of you have tried, and a few of you probably use this on an everyday basis in your work. So I mentioned Mathematica. SageMath is the leading open source version of that. So functionality in many ways similar, not highly developed, not a large company behind it, but still very competitive. And then the advantage that an open source system has, besides being open source and thus verifiable by the user, there's a lot of specialized systems for various branches of mathematics. So GAP and Magna for group theory, certain Cauley 2 is singular for algebraic geometry, commutative algebra, and so forth. And the open source versions, systems of this type have all been incorporated into SageMath. So in terms of the breadth of coverage, that is the broadest. A related topic, which not everybody here has seen, but there's a lot to learn from, are the software development tools that programmers use. So besides programming languages, an important example of that are repositories with version control to keep track of the universal problem that many people are working on, say a program. One person makes a change, another person makes a change. You somehow have to integrate the changes and control the sequence of updating the versions. And there's a system called GitHub, which is by far, the most used. If you're under 30, you've almost certainly used it. In fact, I would say in your projects. And it solves a problem that we also face more broadly as researchers whenever we share a program, a piece of data. Mathematical databases. So the most famous, I think, example of that is the Online Encyclopedia of Integer Sequences of Neil Sloan and collaborators. You can type in a series of integers, and it has millions of known examples that it can identify, useful research tool. And then group theory, an example in string theory is Kreutzer's Scruck database of Claudia manifolds. And I've cited a site which lists about 100 of these mathematical databases, which have been made public. A topic I'll come back to in more detail, interactive theorem verification. So these are systems where you can develop a proof of a mathematical statement, or not just rigorous, but formalized proof and verify it. And there are several very well developed systems, and I'll talk about this at some length. And the famous examples of verified proofs, such as the four-color theorem and the Thomas Hales proof of the Kepler conjecture. This is a slide of a few more experimental projects to get a sense of what sort of research goes on in this field. There's a famous example of a collaborative textbook in algebraic geometry, the Stax project. So sort of a Wikipedia, inspired thing, but at a scholarly level. I'll talk about the mathematical search in more detail shortly. These web-based math collaborations, the Polymath of Tim Gowers and others, solved interesting problems in a number of theories, such as the end gap between primes, conjectures. I'll talk about repositories of verified mathematics and this topic of AI and theorem proving. And I'll talk about the points these illustrate in some detail. So let me come to a concrete topic on that list, and it's mathematical search. So up to that slide, the things were not mature, but at least reasonably well developed, or would be a commercial version. There are people a few people would use the system quite a bit, and people are familiar. But search is something which doesn't exist at the level that we can imagine. Okay, mathematicians such as Tim Gowers have emphasized the value of this. And so the basic concept is clear. We would like to describe the mathematical concept of interest and get back a list of all the material on the web which is relevant to it, claims, proofs. It might be something which our programs or algorithms and so forth. And in the case where we know the name of what we're searching for, the existing search engines, Google and the others, work quite well. So you might have learned, for example, what a sublot space is in the analysis course, but forgotten the details or forgotten some of the theorems that are relevant to that. And if you search for sublot spaces in Google, you will get very helpful answers. There's both there's a good Wikipedia page, there are pointers to articles and textbooks, and so that's the good case where we know that the system works pretty well. But what if you don't know the name of what you're searching for? Perhaps you didn't take that course as a undergraduate, or perhaps you've invented a new concept, even if it's a variation on a concept. If it's something new, how are you supposed to search for that? It obviously does not have an agreed on name. So in most domains, that would seem like a hopeless question, but in mathematics, you can still try to state, what is the thing which I have, looking for or have created? And one can use logic and combine existing concepts to try to define the objects that you're searching for. And of course, it's not in itself a question of text. The formula is not a unique identifier. It could be many formulas. It could be ambiguity. There's many issues in this, but nevertheless, it's sort of like textual search, and one could search for text of formulas on the web. And in fact, there are a couple of examples of this. There's a website, searchonmath.com, which I founded out about in preparing this talk, and so I tried it out. Could we find prime numbers just from the definition as a text? And so here's the search window that this puts up. You type in essentially a LaTeX-like notation, and it puts out, as the first thing, the translation into formatted text. This is not quite the definition of prime. So for given p, there's no n greater than 1 that divides p. Well, I should have also said less than p, but it's close. It has the syntactic content. It's close to the definition. You type it in, and the first entry that comes up is, by definition, how is the prime number represented with the correct definition? So that seemed pretty good. So textual search can get you someplace. And so to try a harder one, here's a basic example of a sublot space. Function is both in L2 of R, and its derivative is in L2 of R. So you can type that into the system. And it doesn't work quite as well in the sense that it didn't come up with a literal definition, but it came up with a page that is talking about sublot spaces and asking a question about them. And it's obviously a very helpful answer. It very much focuses and tells you keywords that could be useful for subsequent searches. So that looks pretty good, but really, as you keep probing the system, it's not as good as those two examples might lead you to believe. So for example, I corrected the search I gave. So I put in n less than, but I changed the name of the variable from p to q in my search, and it didn't work at all. So
how does this work? Is it searching for literally that LaTeX in the file?
It is not doing it in order, but it's doing essentially that, yes. It's clearly very textually based.
Presumably it's looking for similar.
Yeah, that's right. There's a sense of similar, which I haven't looked into here, but I'll talk about it in more interesting cases later. And in any case, it's obviously putting too much reliance on the specific names of variables, and it was helped by the common use of P to denote a prime. Okay, so that you could fix, and a lot of things, of course, can be fixed. And in fact, that particular question of can you give a query where you use dummy variables or anonymous variables. If I said question mark P, say in my query, every time I meant P, it could have matched any variable, keeping question mark P always referring to the same variable. And there's a second search engine by Michael Kohaza, and collaborators, which is actually the default in the ZB Nav website, if you want to try that, which allows that capability. And so that's better, but it's still not that great in my experimentation. So I suppose one gets that working, then, well, that's just the beginning of the questions that this raises, because, of course, the cases where you can just type one formula in terms of elementary concepts are very limited. You can often define very complicated concepts in terms of a simple formula, but only by systematically building up a long tower or series of concepts. If you can't do that, then you're going to be stuck with extremely long formulas, which are going to be very hard to match or reason with. Now, if you are relying on standard concepts, even if they're very standard, there's always questions about the notation and the details of the definition. So, for example, here I'm searching for the idea of a simple group, which, if you have the idea of a normal subgroup, is very easy. All the normal subgroups are either trivial or the whole group. But, try typing normal, but is it normal H, G, or is it normal G, H, or something else? And in fact, in the serious group theory textbooks, it's none of those things. It's just a triangle put on its side is the standard notation. So somehow you have to help the user do that, and you have to have to underline these standard concepts. And I'll talk about that shortly. So let's suppose that works. We're actually getting useful search results. Okay, well, then the next question that this presents is, well, what do you do with the results? Okay, so it presumably was of interest, perhaps some project you might do. So, ideally, and what we often tell our graduate students is, well, you should be able to work the things out yourself. You read the literature, you get the idea. It's a good exercise to work it out yourself. And that's good. And then the other extreme, it might be like a student who has a term paper due in an hour, and found something, let's just copy it and hope for the best. And when I put it that way, of course, it seems like one is better than two, but of course that's simplistic, and there are many correct and useful results out there where the sensible course really is to just use it as correct. And on the other hand, how do you know which ones are correct? So there are various answers to that question, which, again, we won't get to the bottom of this, but one general type of answer is that there is an authority or there is an organization that curates the results, and journals perform this function. There are curated libraries of the most software to perform the software of the broadest utility, such as a numerical linear algebra. So that's good, but not an ideal solution. It's good as far as it goes. It obviously kind of speaks against the whole idea of going out and searching the whole web. You might try to insist on results that you can explicitly check. There are many results of that type that you can evaluate. You might want results that somehow come with a certificate of their correctness. That's not just a case-by-case check, but a stronger statement. So, for example, a thing could come with the actual proof. So the search topic gets us into the broader questions of, what will the computer be able to do for us throughout this whole story to build on previous work? So the whole theme here is, how do we ease the use of previous work? Okay. So let me now switch, having laid out that topic, to computational mathematics. So again, this is a fairly well-known and well-established, in some sense, long before electronic computers, the great mathematicians often were incredibly gifted calculators. Some are famous for that. And with computers, there are many famous examples of topics in mathematics that were either created or substantially developed with this type of help. So the whole theory of dynamical systems received a huge boost from being able to do simulations easily. A lot of the original work on the sporadic, finite, simple groups, the representations and so forth, were worked out by a computer. The Birch, Swinnert, and Dyer conjecture is one of the seven millennial clay problems, and that was based on calculations by these two mathematicians down in the 50s and 60s on elliptic curves. And that type of numerical exploration remains central in some fields. And Simon's collaboration that approaches number theory in this way with many valuable results. So now this gets me into a very easy prediction for 2030. So I've made a list of various things where we can expect progress, and the first one is a sort of easy or simplified version of Moore's Law. So the specifics of Moore's Law, of course, semiconductor integrated circuits are not getting denser, but nevertheless, computers are getting cheaper, storage is getting cheaper, and we're getting more of it. So granting that our computer power available for these problems doubles every year, it's a fairly sad prediction. If we just needed 1,000 times bigger computer to solve a problem we could formulate now, that would happen over the coming decade.
Actually, that's a little optimistic. 1,000
over 10 years. I don't think it really is agreeing with me.
Yeah. Okay.
So a little bit more conceptual. So the whole topic of logic in computer science kind of various flavors, and the simplest would be collections of statements and propositional logic, where you have Boolean variables, and or not, and you're just trying to find a satisfying assignment. And this is a problem of broad industrial use, and there are solvers that can solve systems of millions of clauses. And a benchmark here from a few years ago is the solution of the Boolean Pythagorean triple problem. Okay, so we take the integers from 1 to n. The question is to split them into two disjoint subsets such that neither subset contains a Pythagorean triple, a squared plus b squared equals c squared. And so this group, showed an example of solution for 7824, and they proved that it is not possible for 7825. That's why we need the SAT solver. You get a certificate that shows that that problem has no solution, and it's 200 terabytes long, so that's claimed to be the most longest proof at this point. So that's a fairly easy problem to encode in Boolean logic, because each integer, of course, could have falses is in set A and trues is in set B, and then each of the statements, Pythagorean triple, exists in a single subset, becomes a simple propositional clause. So that one was straightforward in principle. Of course, getting the big solver is a little non-trivial. And then there's a variant of this. What often happens is that you can formulate the problem in a similar way, but the clauses, the actual equations you need to check are expensive, and so you don't want to enumerate them all before you start. You want to work them out on a need-to-know basis. And so there's a SAT plus CAT paradigm where you have a computer algebra system linked to the SAT solver. And a particular group at Waterloo, whose site I get the Math Check Project, has done many problems of this sort. And they tend to be sort of intricate problems with many combinatorial choices, not totally obvious how they fit together. An example is the Williamson conjecture, which comes out of statistics and design of experiments. So the question is, can you find four symmetric n by n matrices, all of whose entries are plus or minus one, such that the sum of the squares is proportional to the identity matrix, and then you can turn that into a Hadamard matrix and so on. And the conjecture of Williamson was that these always exist, but it turns out that this group proved it does not exist for n equals 35, and that's the first case where it does not. It does exist for every even n up to 70, so there's no standing conjecture as to what the solution of this problem is. This was kind of surprising. Another example, little combinatorial, but the subject of a lot of attention in computer science. So the question of, given an n by n, you're multiplying two n by n matrices, what's the minimum number of multiplications that it would take? And although the naive way to do it, say for 2 by 2, for n by n matrices takes n cubed operations, for 2 by 2, you can actually do it using 7 multiplications. I should say the multiplication is usually the more expensive operation, so you can add and subtract and get combinations to reduce the number of multiplications. And you can prove that, in fact, you cannot do 2 by 2 matrix multiplication with less than 7. So that leads to an algorithm for breaking up large matrix multiplications, which is faster than n cubed. And the standing conjecture there is that you could perhaps do it in n squared, but the kernels are always around 2.3 or so, the epoch. So anyways, even for 3x3, there's no solid result. What people have found are many ways, and this group enumerated many ways to do it using 23 multiplications and 27 instead of 27. They found nothing using 22, but they have not disproved them. Okay, so other areas where we can expect progress. This would be one worthy of a talk of its own, especially a workshop like this. That would be a different talk. I'm just going to give an obligatory page and talk about users not, you know, obviously learning has many, many uses, but even just the question of function fitting, interpolation, extrapolation has many, many uses of pure and applied mathematics. And there's very interesting questions as to what function classes do you get that way, which I'm happy to talk with people afterwards. Statistics, okay, so again, not hardly a new field, but one point which I, at least, you know, again, as an outsider looking at this literature, I think there's much more interest in general methods that with a big computer, you don't need to optimize everything. You can try to derive your analysis techniques from more general principles. And so it's a field with, you know, not just more principles, but more overlap between techniques from different subjects that run the common norm in statistics. And I'll give an example from, again, my own field, in this case, experimental particle physics. So not exactly my own field, but close. And this is Jesse Taylor and his group at MIT. So this is analysis of hadron collisions at the LHC. So two particles, energy particles, hit each other and send out thousands of secondary particles. And the question is, can you group these? You expect that these derive from a very few, often two or three, very high energy particles there, but you can only infer their existence statistically from the collections, these jets of many particles. And there are many hand-coded analysis routines developed over the years for breaking down the event in this way. But what this group worked out is you can just do this as a special case of clustering. Okay, so you draw a cylinder around this interaction region and you regard the event as an energy distribution, right? In pixels within this two-dimensional cylinder, such and such amount of energy comes out here, comes out there. You get two functions, and then the natural distance on that space is a Wasserstein distance. It's the minimum amount of effort, in this case, proportional to the distance it would take to move each point, you know, each amount of energy in our problem here, x, to comparable point y in the second distribution, so sometimes called the Earth moves or distance, because you imagine physically moving the Earth. And by using that distance, you can directly turn the problem into a clustering problem. And this works just as well as the handcrafted routines. And you know, again, some handcrafted things come very directly out of this formalism. So it's part it's illustrating this kind of unification given more general concepts. I think there's a trend of pure mathematicians using probabilistic and statistical methods more. And again, if you look at number theory, we recently had the plunge of Brook, I'll speak at Stony Brook. And so this is a question about elliptic curves and the rank of an elliptic curve. So probably, you know, most of you or all of you know what this is, but if you're looking for solutions to a cubic equation in rational numbers, there could be finitely or infinitely many, and the infinite sets are an abelian group. There's an abelian Michelmann, and they can be generated from a minimal set of generators of identity, and then R generators of the abelian group, and that R is the ring. And until a few years ago, it was thought that arbitrarily high existed. It was, I believe it's known as one of the rank 36. It was known to exist and they pinned down the rank. But there's a number of probabilistic models. This one is from putting it out a few years ago that models just not just the rank but several quantities and suggests that once you go above 21, there's only finitely many. The infinite series go up to 21. And again, this is the result of incorporating a great deal of computer evidence, and then just making simple statistical and probabilistic model of it. Okay, so that's this computational and looking, you know, again ahead of the trends. Okay, so now another topic which could be a talk of its own, is clearly very important as well. What, how could technology improve our teaching ability in math, textbooks in particular? So we, you know, many of us have taught, you know, math and physics courses. We've used textbooks which are, you know, well adapted for, say, a, you know, semester-long course with a given topic, but clearly were developed in an area of much simpler and inflexible media. And there's a lot of possibilities, clearly. And on the other hand, of course, just having the possibility doesn't make them worth using. You know, so what actually would improve, is really scope for improvement the textbook. And well, it's easy to throw out ideas. And they're all ideas that the technology exists. It's more just that they haven't been put together, and they're all sufficiently, but not really hard to use, but hard enough to use that a lecturer or a, you know, a textbook author will find it not so easy to use that in their textbook. Okay, so the possibility of having links, suppressing information except when the student wants that, writing one's own notes in an electronic document in a systematic way. Of course, automated grading of exercises would be a great thing. That's harder. That one's not existing technology, but it's interesting talk on this at the high school level that I can recommend if you're interested in that. Social learning. You know, students do use Stack Exchange and Quora and these sites to discuss their problems, and many universities have their own such sites, and it's wise because the students are going to do that, and the point is really to more work with it, and to get the students to benefit from what they're doing. The whole structure of the book, of course, could be, you know, changed in many ways, you know, but you know, what are the ways that would actually help those students learn? I think not nearly enough is being done on this, and I think that's a place which, over the next 10 years, we will see real changes. Okay, I'm going to go over this very quickly, but there are questions that come up if you want to integrate computation itself into the textbook, because there are many books on computational physics, I know, in certain areas of mathematics, but they tend to be, they assume that you know the topic, they then take a particular system of mathematics or mathematical system and work out problems in that particular system, and they don't teach it in a conceptual way, and they don't help the student who is not going to be able to do their work with that single system. They should really know a little bit more about what's behind the software that they're being shown. And let me advertise a good example of a book that is some years old. It's more than 15 years old now, but it's an example by Jerry Sussman and Jack Wisdom at MIT, teaching classical mechanics for celestial mechanics as the main application in a way that integrates computation. Okay? So Sussman in particular is one of the pioneers of AI. And this book assumes, and you know, gives you on the website, here's a symbolic math system and scheme, of course, that you can use. And the basic derivations are given with examples in the system, which they say really does help some students. You know, there are different ways to do it, and sometimes that sort of thing can be missed. It's helpful. Okay, so now let me move on to this final and main topic of the interactive theorem verification. So this is also a old topic that goes back to the early days of AI. And because of that, the field has had a lot of time to develop. There's a whole subfield of computer science called formal methods that focuses on ways to reason about software and maybe bring it in contact with logic. And so the foundation of that is to take a program in a language like C, which is not a language by, you know, in any obvious way. It's a recipe, it's a procedure with step by step, but then you can give it a logical and precise semantics, which isn't based on time, it's based on other concepts, and then you can imagine proving that a program does some particular thing. And that's a very valuable thing in cases, especially like an airplane autopilot, where, you know, it would be worth a lot of money to be able to show that the autopilot cannot make mistakes without some range of its operating ability. And the CPU floating point unit is a famous example. So it was Intel in the early 90s made this famous mistake in the floating point unit of their CPUs. They had to recall them, and it cost $250 million. So now they formally verify their CPUs with the floating point unit. And it is a fairly sizable body of standards of what I'm talking about now, field of people that developed this as well. So just to not be abstract, but to give a sense of you know, what this is an example of the specification of a sorting algorithm in the language on CUP, one of these neural improving systems. So if you're going to prove that a program sorts a list, you have to first say, what does it mean to be sorted? And it's straightforward in some sense. It's a sorting algorithm takes a list to a list, and the second list has to be a permutation of the first list, and the second list has to be sorted. Sorted, well, the order relation is compatible with the precedence relation. And permutation has this nice inductive definition. I'm not sure if everybody can read it, but you know, it's straightforward that these are all properties of permutation. So the empty list is a permutation of itself. You could append an element in front of L and L prime, and they'll still be a permutation. You can append two elements in their transposition, and finally it's transitive, and then that turns out to generate permutations. And then there are textbooks where you can see formally verified proof, say that a particular quicksort algorithm is a sorting algorithm by this specification. So that's the kind of technology that we might try to apply to our research. Okay, so it's get a little bit into an example. Okay, the fundamental theorem of algebra. So as you know, in the complex numbers, they're algebraically closed. If you have a non-constant polynomial, it will have a group. And then now I've written out that statement in the lean theorem proving language. So it's pretty readable. F is a polynomial. Degree is greater than zero. There exists some z such that if I evaluate f, I get zero. Okay, and then just, I won't leave this up, but the proof is, the conceptual proof is this five long. So this proof is going to basically show that the function attains its minimum at some point at z-naught, and then use properties of complex numbers to show that the magnitude has to decrease in some direction if at that point it's not zero. So a contradiction if the minimum is not zero.
What topology is this program now to know that f attains its minimum?
It does. We have to define it. It knows the standard definition in terms of points at the topology on R2 in this case. So it has to set of open sets and closed sets. I won't quote enough of the theorem, but I can show it to you if you're curious, all those definitions. So that is indeed that first, this is the proof of that first statement. And it is bringing in various statements about topology in the proof, which are defined in another library. And basically, the message I'm going to take is that not just this, but very strong mathematicians have the sense that all interesting mathematics can now at this point be defined in these systems. And on the other hand,
this is written by a computer.
No, this is written by a person. Okay. It is verified by a computer. So the computer can trace through and say, you're right, this does prove. So the statement is, resist to x such that for all y, the absolute value of value at x is less than or equal to the absolute value of value at y. So the statement, I find quite straightforward. The proof requires quite a bit of decoding, and there are various reasons for that. So the language is sort of uncompromising in the sense that the syntax is terse in a computer language like. The previous definitions, again, some of them are standard definitions for topology, but some of them are just little lemmas that you define in the course of making this duality of compact and continuous. And you can unwrap it once you look at the definition, but having to remember definitions like that and working with this is certainly a turnoff for me and many people. And then it's sprinkled with these commands like RW and SEP. And these are the tactics of the proof. So this is saying that we take this, turns out to be a relevant equation, and we use it to rewrite the goal at that point as a step in proving it. There's a point where the required reasoning steps were so simple that the computer could figure it out. We limited class of those. And so there's maybe 40 or 50 of those tactics that you have to know. And so that's an example. And again, I'm happy to try to go through these things in more detail after the talk for people who are interested. But the basic upshot at present is that this is a hard thing to do. Okay, this is not just hard to write, it's kind of hard to read. Okay, the learning curve is, I have not got to the point where I could write that, and I have a little trouble reading it. And after a year of working on this, you can write things like that. So it's a hard thing to learn, yes. On the other hand, I would certainly maintain, I mean, some people maintain, this is really not just important, but central. Okay, and that's an intuition at this point, but it's to basically say that, first of all, this is the core of mathematics. Where the arguments from looking at the mathematical search problem that I talked about earlier that showed that if you go very far, even in a different direction, such as search, you will find yourself wanting to do this. And then, well, does the computer understand anything? You know, you can debate it, but there's some sense in which being able to verify is an understanding of truth. So there are various intuitions that would suggest that despite the difficulty, this is important to use and make progress on. So what to do? Okay, so one observation is that the definitions really were easier to write and understand than the approvals. You might focus on that. Deductive logic isn't necessary, it's certainly not the only reasoning method. If you're trying to produce rigorous proofs, well, that is pretty much the only reasoning method. But if you have other applications for reasoning, then other things can be interesting. I'll put it for sake of time. And finally, one could hope that bringing in AI and applying it to these problems will help. Okay, so as far as the first of the definitions, so mathematician Thomas Hale at Pittsburgh, I'll come back to why this is, that he's probably, after Vygotsky's tragic passing, the mathematician who is the most experienced and the most knowledge of these theorem proofs, has begun a project that he calls the Formal Abstract Project. And what it is to make a repository, so in some sense like the archive, but what you submit to this repository are the formal statements of the results that you feel your work has proved. So you aren't asked to submit the proofs at this point, but you're asked to submit the statement of the result in a way that could be verified. Okay, so his project is, you must use the Wien theorem proof, which I showed you. You are offering a big library of standard concepts if you're going to put research on the mathematics in this. But we've estimated, and actually there's independent estimates, that 50,000 definitions would cover, by far most of the mathematics, so about 10,000 pages. So something that a group of 100 people could do in a year. Yeah.
So you're focusing on, I would call it, pure math papers that, are stating these either true or false. But if we go...
Let me come back. Well, this is probably an open-end question, which is good for a discussion. That's right.
I'll just say the question, if you were to try to do this in biology, then this group took this gene, did a knockout, and noticed that on this type of mice, it created obesity. But that group took that gene, knocked it out in pigs, and the pigs lived to
200. There's a lot of scope, obviously, for computation help with that, too. And there could be an equally long talk, and exactly, this is where I put the cut, a subject where you could, in principle, say something is probably wrong. Well, archive, you could submit anything, but it has no tools to help you submit a formal abstract, and they might even reject it because they have this filter that the thing should look like a natural language. Here, you're supposed to submit something like this, the line 12 and 13 in this thing, to give a trivial example of something you could submit to this.
But this thing doesn't check the validity.
It doesn't check it, that's right. So you can debate how useful it is. Right, so that's right. Checking it without the theorem, without the proof, is very difficult. And asking the people to make the proof at this point in time is too difficult. But nevertheless, this would have value. That's the concept behind it. Right? You can search, you can organize the field of mathematics. Another point that Thomas, what he's working on right now, is a controlled natural language. So this is statements from the discussion of silos theorem and group theory. And although this looks like it comes out of a math textbook, and perhaps it could, these are written in a controlled language that can actually be parsed into those lean definitions that I wrote earlier. So here's another page of that. So it's carefully chosen, you know, so that it's readable and yet has a precise formal meaning. And so Tom's hope is that one will be able to submit statements of this type to the system. Okay. So let me come back to this question of the AI. And how much time do I have? Because now these are things which...
A few more minutes.
Okay, so many of you have probably seen things about the use of this to verify large groups, like the four-color group. Tom Hales verified the Kepler conjecture doing this. This is a technology which, even for human, there are very long groups, such as the classification of the finite simple groups, where it almost exceeds the ability even of a human collaboration to work with the group. There are cases in physics where there are calculations which would be valuable to verify, and in fact, famous mistakes were made. And I'll just quickly cite the G minus 2 of the muon in the status, not now, but in the late 1990s, was actually increasing a disagreement between the experimental result and the theory, but it was due to a mistake. And in fact, here's a paper that explained the mistake. These were not the people who caught it, but what they had done was this calculation has to be built up out of several parts, and there's this part that you have to basically, it's hydronic, light by light scattering as you relate to experimental data. And in the process of doing it, they didn't realize the sign convention of a symbolic mass system they were using, and so they added that term with the wrong sign. And so that's clearly a case where verification would have saved by physicists okay. So now go over this AI and the AI improvement. Yeah. I like this slide. And surprised nobody used it elsewhere. Okay, so now this question of trying to automate better the interactive theorem verification. I described there are several groups. So down here, groups at Google and other places are working on this. And if you are developing a verifiable proof of the sort we described, there are many choices, but the main choices are to choose the premises, both from your current proof and from a library of proof statements, which are the relevant ones to make it use the next step of deduction. And then when you use tactics, what is the relevant tactic to use to advance the proof and not move it in some useless direction? And you could think of this as like a game of solitaire, where you win if you complete the proof of the theorem. And that suggests treating it like a game and solving it using a reinforcement learning, and that is how most of these groups work on this. So you have a corpus of proven theorems. They're short because you break up a big thing like this four-color theorem into lots of little lemmas that might be the proof 5 or 10 lines long. But then you have of order 50,000, maybe 150,000 in the biggest case of the Koch corpus. And then you can use some of those as a training set of theorem proof on which to train these choices of premise and tactic. And then look at the held out testing set and see what percentage of those your prover now can prove. And they've actually gotten it up to about 50%. And so given not a huge amount of other time into this, I find that quite promising. Of course, that's not a huge amount of data, 100,000 theorem. Now, if you could read the archive and somehow mine that, that would be a very, set of data with reckoning with. I can tell you more details about thinking about this. Some groups are trying to work on that. The other possibility, of course, would be to try to do self-learning or self-data generation. So the big advantage of AlphaGo and game playing in general, of course, is that the machine plays against itself and generates arbitrary amounts of data. And in fact, that's where most, by far, the computing time of training off at zero wasn't just playing games against itself, and it costs several $1 million, the computer project that they used to do that. So if you could do that in mathematics, clearly you would have an arbitrary amount of training data, but now you raise questions like, what does it mean to win a game? It's a two-player game, it's clear that you do better than the other player, but generating true statements by deduction is not doing mathematics. You don't do anything for that. And so there has to be some measure of what theorems are interesting or significant or useful. There's been relatively little work on that, but that's not to say it can't be done. So again, this one of these topics recognized in the early days of AI, and had interesting discussions with David McAllister of computer sciences in Chicago, who's been working on this problem. But I'll leave that for that private discussion. Okay. So let me summarize. There are some straightforward lines of progress in computers applied to mathematics that I've illustrated in the talk. And let me use those to now speculate to how far, what will we have by 2030. Okay, so I do think that this area of textbooks that both integrate computation into the discussion and make proper use of the many options in modern digital media is a it's not low hanging fruit, at least an area that is underexplored and that we'll see progress. Clearly computational mathematics will continue in the kind of vein that we saw, and problems where there's a large natural database to generate, or problems with intricate combinatorial constraint satisfaction problems, those will be the mainstay of these sorts of methods. These interactive theorem verifiers will be much easier to use, and that this type of AI automation will progress, and I predict that and by 2030, this will be comparable to the way we think of mathematics and sage math now. That's something which does not take years to learn, but you read a book and you play with it for a month, and then you can use it in your projects. Some people will like it and use it all the time. Many people will use it occasionally. And again, that's extrapolating very much, but I think that's a reasonable extrapolation for the coming decade. Okay, and a large database of formal mathematics, perhaps this formal abstracts project will exist. Perhaps there will be an ability to parse, auto-formalize human text from the web that will enable a real semantic mathematical search of the type that I talked about. And the test of the non-trivial nature of such a search is if you type in a search term and you get back some answer from some other field, which is relevant for your search, but nobody had actually realized that that concept in that other field is relevant for your search. So those sorts of discoveries are made, and that would be the test of such a thing actually giving meaningful new search results. There's a whole, again, slightly different direction of how this gets applied to simulation, to physics, to problems where we have this vast sort of library of code and many results, and the problem is to find it and integrate it and to maintain it. So that's another talk that is relevant to that. Will computers have proven any non-trivial mathematical result by themselves, or come up with an interesting conjecture? So that's a question that we would ask. And this is my thought to contribute to that. Okay? So. I don't think we can know at this point, even over the coming decade, but the principle that I would throw out for this is that if you have a breakthrough, there will be a breakthrough that shows that new capabilities in the field that really do take you some distance towards the goal, and that then will take about 10 years to fully realize the consequence of. And so if we look at mathematics, computers cannot do general reasoning. When computers do reasoning, it's this type of formal reasoning, logic of problems that have already been spelled out in formal terms. But people work actively on trying to get computers to answer larger classes of questions and do other varieties of what you might call general reasoning. Now, I don't think math reasoning is any simpler than
than the reasoning. I don't think it's any harder either than the reasoning in most fields of human endeavor than to require reasoning. In fact, it clearly will be much more industrial effort. And there's much more training data for questions that have to do with the everyday world, and reasoning about travel, you know, or finance or medicine. But the advantage of math, of course, is that unlike most things in human life, reasoning is the main part of it, and you can build up a long chain of reasoning. You know, so if you're a lawyer and you reason, you know, what, you know, your case, what your opponent might do three steps ahead, you know, you might as well knock it off and you know, call it a day, because, you know, what's the chances that things will continue to go along that way? There's just so many uncertainties. But in math, you can write full, you know, books. There are chains of meaningful reasoning. So once a computer has any ability to do general reasoning, this is the point where it will first show some sort of dramatic ability based on that. And as I said, we don't have that. But then if we did, I would look for some of these things to start happening on this 10-year time scale.